Thank you all of you for being here and give me the opportunity to present the work that I have done in the last year and a half in Bologna, working on this Spritz simulation that is particularly suited for simulating the infrared sky. So the original idea of this work was to find a tool that could be used to do some prediction for future infrared telescopes, in particular for starting from the SPICA mission and then expanded to other future infrared telescopes such as JWST, OST, or Euclid. And the basic idea, if you want, is to think to do this is to use available semi-empirical or hydrodynamical simulation, or to extrapolate what we know from optical and near-infrared observation. However, there is a population of infrared sky, infrared galaxies that is particularly challenging when doing some prediction or comparison with infrared observation. And these are what I call here dusty monsters, and are the most luminous galaxy in the infrared. So here on the left, you can see the energy density evolution on the infrared. And in green, there is the total amount, while with different color, there is the contribution of galaxy depending on the infrared threshold. And so you can see that the most luminous galaxies are quite rare at the local universe, but the contribution increase with redshift. And here, this show only up to redshift of one, for example. And these very extreme galaxies are quite challenging to simulate. And here on the right, you can see, for example, the number density of these galaxies above 10 to the 13. So these are even more brighter. They're called hyperlirg. And their number density with different redshift. And the data points here show observation. And in the black, there are the prediction from this is just an example. It's the Galform simulation. So you can see that their number is underpredict, particularly at higher redshift. And if you go and look, for example, just at one wavelength, for example, the 12 micrometer luminosity, you see a similar behavior. Here in yellow, there are the data points, the observations at very low redshift. And in gray, you see the comparison with the prediction from the hydrodynamical simulation Eagle. And here again, you can see that the number of the very bright galaxy is underestimated. And as the infrared luminosity is linked to the star formation rate, you have a similar behavior when you look at the star formation rate function. Here, in yellow, there are again the data, and the different lines show here different predictions for different models. And you have again that the most active and the most infrared luminous galaxy are underpredicted. So we see that we cannot use directly the semi-empirical and hydrodynamical simulation to do the prediction for future infrared telescope, as they have issue with the very bright object. So can we just somehow use the optical and near-infrared observation extrapolated considering the dust extinction? The problem is that recent works have shown that there is a population of galaxy that is completely invisible at these optical and near-infrared wavelengths. This is an example from the Alpine survey, but I listed here other works. And here there is just an example of a very bright galaxy observed by ALMA, which is completely missed at other wavelengths. So here there is even the near-infrared, and you can see that there is nothing at all there. So if we just take these, the optical and near infrared observation, we correct for dust and we predict what we can see from the infrared, we would miss totally this population, which is not really negligible, as here I showed the star formation rate density, and this is the total amount from the same Alpine survey. And here there is the contribution of these optical and near infrared dark galaxy. So you can see that they contribute at least up to 10%, and this is an estimate done considering the few information that we have about this observation. And so we cannot really use neither some extrapolation from optical and near-infrared observation, at least not directly. And so we decide to create a new simulation. And the idea, the basic point of this simulation is that we want it to be consistent with infrared observation. And we wanted to contain both star formation and AGN activity in a consistent way. as these as both the population contribute to the infrared light. And so with this in mind, we create the SPRIT simulation that I will now talk about. And you can find it already on the archive as we submitted a paper a few months ago. Okay, so in the rest of the talk, I will go and give you a bit of information about the structure of this simulation and how I create mock catalogs from it. Then I will move showing a bit of some comparisons with observation in order to validate the simulation. And then when I'll finish with some application to future infrared telescopes. And so I will start with the structure. So this is just a bit a workflow of the entire simulation. I will go through the different steps a bit slower later. So we start from the luminosity function of different galaxy population. We assign the some templates to this simulate galaxy and the luminosity function derived from the luminosity function. And with this template, we derive the expected flux noise without any noise. The expected fluxes in different filters without any noise, and physical properties and emission features. This allows us to derive a master catalog, that is a catalog that has no flux limit and contain the average physical properties of the different galaxies. Then we can use this catalog as starting point, and considering the observing plans of the desired survey that one wants to simulate, we can derive the simulated fluxes and spectra, this time with the expected noise, and we assign a spatial distribution to them. In this way, we derive the simulated catalog and the final simulated images and spectra. So I said this is the overall workflow, and I will now go on the different steps to give a bit more details. So as I said, we start considering different galaxy population. We start from the Herschel observation, so we consider first two populations that are dominated by star formation. And these are the spiral galaxy and the starburst galaxy. And this differs by the amount of star formation going on and the temperature of the dust. Then we have two population of AGN dominated galaxy. These are called AGN1 and AGN2 in our simulation. And the main difference is in the optical, as the AGN2 is obscure while the AGN1 is completely visible. Then we have two population of mixed object that contain an AGN, which is however not dominant at any wavelength except in the mid-infrared. So these are called star-forming AGN in our simulation and starburst AGN. And the main difference is that the star-forming AGN contain a low luminosity AGN. So like local Seyfert galaxy would fall inside this galaxy population. While instead, starburst AGN contain a very bright AGN that is, however, extremely obscure. Then, as we wanted to verify what is possible to observe beyond Herschel, and in principle also consider this simulation at other wavelengths, we also include two other populations that were not observed by Herschel. And these are elliptical galaxies, or at least not observed in great number, we can say. These are elliptical galaxy and irregular galaxy. Of course, the elliptical galaxy dominate the high mass end of the stellar mass function, while irregulars are more low mass systems. So to all these different galaxy population, we associate luminosity functions. So for the one observed by Herschel, we consider the Herschel infrared luminosity as derived by Gruppioni a few years ago. And for the AGNs, we improve the luminosity function considering also UV observation available in the literature. Instead, for the elliptical galaxy and irregular, for the elliptical, we consider an average of available K-band luminosity function available in the literature, and we consider three different works that perform a color selection to derive the luminosity function for elliptical. And this is necessary because otherwise we would include again some other galaxy population that of course are visible also in the K-band. And then for the stellar, for the irregular galaxy, we instead consider the stellar mass function by Huerta's company. The Herschel luminosity function of course has been derived only up to three because we don't have many information above that redshift. And we extrapolate this information at higher redshift. In particular, we consider the characteristic luminosity as a constant with redshift, while we decrease the characteristic density as a power law with the redshift. And the power law slope, we consider four different values, and I will show later the comparison with the observation of this extrapolation. Okay, so to all these this luminosity function has, then are used to derive the expected number of galaxies for each population, depending on the infrared luminosity and the redshift. And to this simulated galaxy, we associated some templates. Here for the Herschel one, so the going spiral starburst and the AGNs, we consider the same templates that were used to derive the infrared luminosity function, just to be consistent with the luminosity function. And these are mainly derived from the Pauletta's work Then we also consider the elliptical templates from the same work, just for consistency, while for irregular galaxy, as there are no templates inside the Pauletta's work, we consider the templates from Bianchi's work a few years ago. And then we use these templates to derive physical properties. So we derive the stellar mass for this template, the dust extinction, the star formation rate. Then for the galaxy containing an AGN, we perform a decomposition to derive also the AGN properties. And this allows us to obtain the AGN fraction, the accretion luminosity, and the hydrogen column density. In addition, we use some empirical relation finding in the literature to derive the X-ray luminosity, the metallicity through the mass metallicity relation, and the radio luminosity at 1.4 GHz and at 150 MHz. As I said, when the AGN is present, we perform a decomposition to derive the AGN properties, and this is done considering two different torus models, a smooth one and a clumpy one. We consider both because the observation don't really help to discriminate between them, and so we don't know what is in reality, the structure of the torus, and the properties derived with the two are slightly different. This is an example where I show the templates normalized to the same infrared luminosity, and I show the stellar mass derived with the smooth model and with the torus model. The main difference is in the hydrogen column density that I show instead here, because the smooth torus model has an upper limit above which is not possible to go. And this is a range that is useful if you want to analyze, for example, Compton thick AGN. And indeed, the starburst AGN population show very high hydrogen column density with the clumpy torus model. So this shows the necessity of having both models. Then we include, as I said, different emission features. Now, don't be afraid of all these numbers. don't be scared of all these numbers. Here I show a table showing all the lines that I included in the infrared. And this is done considering three different empirical relations that link the infrared luminosity to the luminosity of some of these lines, and links the total infrared luminosity or the one decomposed between AGN and star formation, depending on the work. Then for the optical instead, I include the hydrogen emission lines considering the theoretical relations and the link between star formation rate and H-alpha. And then for the other lines, I instead used several empirical relation finding in the literature that depends on the lines. This is for the part due to the star formation, while for the AGN, I consider the cloudy photoionization model. So in the full simulation, we have both the contribution of the AGN and the star formation to all the lines present. For the AGN, we consider only the emission coming from the narrow line region, but in the next step, we'll try to include also the broad line region as well. So once we have the fluxes, the physical properties of the galaxies, we need to distribute them in the sky. And so we do it by using the algorithm by Sonera and Peebles that allow to distribute galaxies following an angular two-point correlation function. And then we fine-tune the normalization of the correlation function to have a clustering that depends on the stellar mass. Now, going a bit on the details on the just briefly on the algorithm, this so starting from a circle of a certain radius, we extract a number of points, n that is then used to define other circle with a smaller radius that are used to extract new positions, And this procedure is iterated until we reach the number of positions that we desire. And the parameters that describe the radius and the decrease in the radius and the number of points can be fine-tuned to produce the desired angular two-point correlation function. So this is just an example of the output where we have one square degree and all the points here are simulated galaxy inside the spritz, and they are color-coded, depends on the redshift. And so you can see that the distribution is not uniform and there are under-dense region and more dense region as we desire. Okay, then the last point is to add, to have the photometry and the spectroscopy that are the main observable. And we consider in particular, at the moment we have like 140 filters for the photometry, but they can be increased easily. And these are for a number of current and future telescope, not only in the infrared. And for the spectroscopy, we have at the moment three possibility. One is to have the SPICA SMI, as I said, this started inside the SPICA collaboration, this project. And then we there is the possibility to simulate the JWST MIRI low resolution spectroscopy and the OST OSS spectrometer. And this is an example of a spectra for JWST MIRI. So you see the range going from 5 to 12 micrometer. And in black, I show the original template without any emission line. In red, I include the emission line. And in green, you can see the final spectra with the noise. Okay, so this was the general overview of the structure of the split simulation. And now I can give you a bit of, I can show you a bit the comparison with observation to validate this simulation. So we start looking at the high redshift extrapolation. As I said, we consider the Herschel luminosity function that is observed up to redshift of 3. Then we keep the characteristic luminosity constant and we change the density with the redshift, considering 4 different power laws that go from -4 to -1. And here I show the result for redshift 4 and a bit more than 5. And the data points here are coming from the Alpine survey that I showed you a bit of the results before. And the lines, the different lines here show the different extrapolation. And you can see that at redshift 4, all our extrapolation are consistent with the data. While at redshift of 5, the steeper extrapolation that predicts a smaller amount of galaxy start to be in tension with observation. And therefore, in the next slide, I will consider the one with the flattened evolution as the fiducial simulation. And I will include the other only inside the error bars. Okay, so these are the number counts at different wavelengths. These go from the U band to the optical and near infrared. And then here from the 11 micrometer up to the far infrared at 850. This part is still in progress as there are some tension with observation that we need to improve. But in general, you can see here in, with the black lines, the fiducial model. As I said, the gray area showed the error bars. So these include the high redshift extrapolation and the errors on the starting luminosity function. Here for the optical and near infrared, all the data are taken from the candles and gamma survey, while here are taken from a set of numerous different works. You can find that in general, simulation is in agreement with observation, except in few cases where we have a bit of tensions. Moving on more, some physical parameters, this is the stellar mass. This go again from redshift 0.3, more or less, to redshift of 4.5. Again, the solid black line is our fiducial simulation, and the gray area show the errors. The different lines here, color lines, show the contribution of the different galaxy population, and the crosses and circles are values from the literature. You can see that our simulation is in agreement with observation, at least above redshift of 1. Below, we have some tension in the massive end that we underestimated. And this is instead the stellar mass and star formation rate plane. So you probably know that the star forming galaxy generally show a tight correlation between star formation and stellar mass. And this is called main sequence of star formation. And here I report the main sequence from different value in the literature, from redshift 0 to redshift 7. And I also show the locus of Starbus galaxy that is showing in magenta and in pink, and depending on the redshift. In background are the results from the simulation. So in red, there are elliptical galaxies, and they are by construction in this area, as we assign a specific star formation rate to them that is consistent with this area of the star formation rate stellar mass plane. Only in blue, instead, we have all star-forming galaxies, and the different colors indicate the different density. So here we include the star formation rate, both obscure and unobscure. And you can see that the simulation is in agreement with observation. So we have that the star-forming galaxies are in the area expected for the main sequence. We have even Starbus galaxy, at least up to redshift of 3. Then above, we start to have only star-forming galaxy. We don't have templates so active to reproduce the Starbus galaxy at this high redshift. And at the very high redshift, around 6, we even have some problem with star-forming galaxy. It's interesting to know that as we know, the main sequence normalization increase with redshift. And we have a similar behavior even here, but that is only due to the evolution of the infrared luminosity function. So it's a consequence of that. Now I will show some luminosity function jumping from one wavelength to the other. If you are interested in other wavelengths, I may have them as a backup line slides. So we start from the UV. So here there is the UV luminosity function going from redshift 0.5 up to redshift of 5. And here the extremely bright end is populated by quasar, and that is reproduced by construction because we use this information to improve the luminosity function of agents. So you mainly need to look at the intermediate at faint end. And in general, we are in agreement with observation. We have a bit of, we overestimate the intermediate luminosity at low redshift. But then we are in agreement with observation, but we start to underestimate a bit the overall function, particularly at high redshift. We are still inside in agreement considering the large error bars, but there is tension. The fiducial model underestimates this, and this can be due to a too simplistic approach to simulate irregular galaxy. Or we may need to include an extra population of galaxy bright in the UV but faint in the infrared wavelengths. And we can now move at X-ray. So we derive the X-ray luminosity. So there are two different relations that we consider to derive the X-ray luminosity. One is from the 12 micrometer luminosity. The relation is from Asmus a few years ago. And this has been derived considering infrared and X-ray detected galaxy. But this relation has been derived up to a luminosity of 10 to the 45 Earth per second. A flattening may be present at higher luminosity, but the data of this work were not sufficient enough to identify it. The other method is to consider the accretion luminosity that we derive from the AGN decomposition and use a volumetric correction, for example, the one from Duras of last year. And this has been derived considering X-ray AGNs. And you can see here the comparison between the luminosity derived with the two methods. This is for the smooth torus model, and this is for the clumpy torus model. You can see that for AGNs, bright, for system dominated by the AGN, what we call here AGN1 and AGN2, the two luminosity are in agreement, at least for the clumpy torus model, while there is a disagreement for the Starbus AGN, that here I remember you is the population with the most obscure AGNs. while there are more differences if we consider the smooth torus model. So our approach is to consider the X-ray luminosity from the 12 micrometer luminosity, at least up to 10 to the 45 where it's derived. And then for higher luminosity, we consider the relation from Duras. And so we derive it from the bolometric correction. So now we can compare it with observation. Here we have the luminosity function from redshift 0.5 to redshift of 6. And here the different points show the data available in the literature. The solid lines show our prediction. And here I showed also the prediction if we consider just one of the two relations. So here with the dashed line, we have the relation if we have the luminosity function if we consider only the 12 micrometer relation. And so we can see that we overestimate the bright end if we consider just that relation. While if we consider only the luminosity coming from the volumetric correction, we have this dotted dashed line and we see that we overestimate the faint end. So a combination of the two is the best approach. And we can see that we are consistent with the data at the bright end, at intermediate luminosity, while we overestimate the faint end. And this overestimation moves at higher and higher luminosity with the redshift until we are consistent with observation only in the bright end at very high redshift. So we need to work a bit more on understanding the discrepancy between the observation and the simulation. And here I have to say that we include only the X-ray emission coming from the agent. So an additional next step will be also to include the X-ray emission coming from the galaxies and not only from the agent. So jumping to other wavelengths, we have here the 1.4 gigahertz luminosity function. So we move to the radio. And I show here on the left the luminosity function for star-forming galaxy and on the right the luminosity function for radio-loud AGN. So for the star-forming galaxy, we derive the luminosity from the relation between infrared luminosity and the 1.4 gigahertz luminosity function. And we have, again, the solid line is our prediction and the different points indicate the value in the literature. And so we are consistent up to redshift of 5. On the left, on the right instead, you can see the luminosity function for the radio loud galaxies. Here, the galaxy, so we derive the fraction of radio loud AGN from the relation found by BEST 15 years ago. And this relation, so the fraction of radio loud AGN depends on the stellar mass following this relation. And then we use the luminosity evolution of the luminosity function for radio loud AGN by Smolcich. And in using these two relations, we are able to simulate the luminosity function for radio loud AGN. Again, the solid line indicate the fiducial model, while all the points are the value that we found from the literature. Here it's necessary to say that we consider a single radio loud population. We didn't discriminate between high or low excitation modes, and this would be part in case of future works. And this is the last validation that we did. It was to check the inclusion of emission line, and we verified the position of the agents and star-forming galaxy in the famous BPT diagram. So this diagram used two line ratios to discriminate between agents and star formation. And here I show our simulated galaxy from redshift 0.5 up to redshift of 5. So the solid line here showed the separation between the AGN locus and the star formation locus. And this has been derived up to redshift of 3. And at higher redshift, we just show a simple extrapolation. So in orange, we show all the galaxies without an AGN in our simulation, and they are all below the separation line. Instead, color-coded from blue to yellow, we have the galaxy that contain an AGN. This all plot is without any error, so these are the true values that we assign to the galaxy. And so the galaxy with an AGN, the majority of them stay above the separation line with few galaxy with a small fraction of AGN that are very close to the separation boundary. And so now I can move and give you just a few show just few applications for infrared telescopes. So I start from JWST, and this is a simulated.
Sorry, I don't know if it's just my problem, but I see from some minutes this slide with the X-ray LF. I don't know if it was just my problem, or so other people had similar issue.
So you just see this one?
No, I don't see anything. I just see always that one, the slide where the.
I was seeing everything.
Okay, so it was you.
Sorry. I try to be sure. So sorry. So go on your.
So you see everything again.
Okay. Sorry. So it is good that all the rest of people did not have any problems. So.
I didn't talk alone.
Okay.
So I would say now I will go on and show just some application to future infrared telescope. So I will start with JWST, and this is a simulated near camp three color image. So here I show three different filters in blue, green, and red. The black lines that you can see are due to the NIRCam structure, so it's what I tried to simulate. And all the dots that you can see here are galaxies simulated in our inside Spritz. And I included the PSF, as you can see, the PSF from JWST, as you can see for the brightest galaxy here, but they are all point-like. So this may be an issue if you are interested in a low redshift or intermediate redshift galaxy. And so one of the next steps will be to try to include morphology when simulate images. And this is an example of some application to instead Spica mission. And you can think about as a general application to mid-size infrared telescopes. Here on the right, you can see a compilation of some spectra, just used as example. They go from 70 to 36 micrometer observed frame. And I show just few examples of different redshift and for different population. And these can be used, for example, to identify what is the fraction of galaxy for which we expect to detect a specific emission feature. So, for example, here on the left, I show for two different surveys. The first one is a deep but a small field, while the one below is a shallower but larger field. And what I show with the solid line is the prediction for the galaxy detected in photometry, considering the Spica capabilities. And instead, the different histogram color one show the distribution of galaxy for which we expected to have a detection in one of the different hydrogen lines. This contain both star formation and AGN contribution. And this can be useful, of course, to identify the which redshift is more useful when you are interested in having a detection on the hydrogen lines, or more generally to identify the fraction of galaxy for which we expect to have a good redshift estimate, as we have more lines, more detection in multiple lines. And this is instead some prediction for the Orion Space Telescope. These are all work in progress, in particular because I have put here some arbitrary flux limit and area, and in the future I will update it with the plan for OST. And what I show here is the redshift distribution of the galaxy detected at 50 micrometer and 250 micrometer. And the black line show the results for the fiducial simulation, while the gray area show how much it change if we change extrapolation. And the different lines show again the different populations, so one can really investigate what type of galaxy we expect to see, and not only the number. And this can be also analyzed looking at other properties, as for all these simulated galaxies, we have other physical properties, like the infrared luminosity. Sorry, I forgot here to put infrared. And you can see how the infrared luminosity of the galaxy shown here change with redshift, and what are the limits that we expect given the area and the depth that we consider. And this is just the last prediction that show the number density instead of the AGNs that we expect to observe in photometry with Euclid, just considering one band and the area of Euclid. So this show the capability of Spritz to simulate also extremely large areas in the sky. And this show, for example, that we expect to observe very obscure AGN only up to redshift of 3. And above that, we only will be able to observe, as we may expect, quasars, AGN1, what we call here AGN1 galaxies. And so this was the overall view of the Spritz simulation. As I said, it was tuned to reproduce the infrared sky and to treat in a consistent way both star formation and AGN. This can be used to have simulated images and spectra. And you can find the submitted paper in the archive, but there is also a website where where you can find the simulation and you can you play with it. A new version will be available soon. And if you have a specific survey that you would like to simulate and I haven't included, you can just talk to me.